So, the first thing about affirmations, you know, I think most people, when they learn about affirmations, they get really excited. You know, raise your hand if that was with you, you know. So, you mean I can just repeat these things to myself and they'll become true for me? And also, a lot of people, after a while, maybe a few months of trying these affirmations, you know, like, I am healthy, I am wealthy, and I'm wise, and then a few months later, you realize, well, nothing has really changed. And so why do affirmations not work sometimes? A lot of people call the unconscious, you know, the mind that is actually always acting, the mind that is always recording, that is called the unconscious mind. And I don't like that term because that's the one that's really always operating. You know, cell biologist Bruce Lipton, who wrote the book The Biology of Belief, he says it's like this whole wall in the back here, if that was your mind, and you went on there with a pin and made a dot with a pin, that would be the part of your mind that you're actually conscious of at any given moment. And all the rest would be what they call the unconscious mind, but I like to call that the background mind. So, for affirmations really to take hold in a person's life, you need the cooperation of the background mind. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because otherwise you have a thin size power trying to move the whole wall size, right? So for affirmations to really take hold in a person's life, you have to believe them in your background mind. You need to get the cooperation of the background mind. But that was not always easy. So one of the things that keeps coming up in a, you know, the movie The Secret and all things related to the law of attraction is that you need to come up with affirmations that are believable to you. For example, if you are saying, well, I am wealthy, constantly repeating that to you, but your income hasn't changed, the amount of property that you own hasn't changed, you're still driving the same beat-up car, you know, whatever it is. It's going to be really hard for you to believe that. So they say, well, choose an affirmation that you could actually believe. For example, if you tell yourself, well, I am wealthy, and you look at your car, say, for example, and the car is saying, no, that's not true, right? So a more positive affirmation, or a more effective affirmation, could be to say, every day I am getting closer to wealth, or to being more wealthy. I am working, and God is working in my life so that every day, every month, every year, I can be more wealthy. And that seems more believable because then you're talking about a path. You're not talking about something that, as if it has already materialized, when everything in your life is saying that's not true, right? So you probably all are familiar with that, you know, that you need to use affirmations that right here, right now, seem believable to you. But what happens, you know, and this is what I want to talk about today, and let's start with the example of the car, since I already mentioned it. So, when you're telling yourself, I am wealthy, right, or I am on my path to greater wealth, and you look around in your environment, and you look at your house, or you look at your car, and maybe the car that you're driving is not the car that you would like to drive, or a car that would tell, give you the feedback that yes, you are doing well, that yes, you are wealthy. And so there's this constant war between you trying to make a transformation in your life by using positive affirmations, and at the same time reality telling you, no, that's not so, that's not it. So what to do in that case? And one of the things I do, you know, one of my businesses is feng shui. And feng shui is about working with the environment. What a feng shui consultant does is a feng shui consultant assesses the health of the spaces in and around buildings, both in urban and rural areas, to determine whether human life can thrive in them. This is done using methods similar to what an acupuncturist would use to assess the health of a person. Actually, acupuncture and feng shui share all of the same principles. Feng shui is considered one of the five branches of traditional Chinese medicine. And the other four being acupuncture, the study of herbs, qigong or tai chi, and massage. And the fifth one is feng shui. So it is a healing art based on the principles of traditional Asian thought. And these principles, they're not just a philosophy. They're actually based on the observation of nature and of people's interaction with nature over thousands of years. So, when a feng shui consultant or advisor works on a home or business, we check certain things to see that certain conditions are met for the physical, the emotional, and the mental well-being of the person. Okay? So, because of being involved with Feng Shui for about a decade, I have had an opportunity to see very closely how people relate to the space and how there's always a feedback loop established. Okay. So, why is it important to create a positive feedback loop between the way you live, what you are thinking, the affirmations that you are saying, and your space? It's because if you're not consciously doing it, you're most likely stuck in a negative feedback loop. So, say for example that, does somebody want to give me an affirmation? That just an example of an affirmation that somebody might use to try to improve the conditions in their life?
I am strong and trim.
I am strong and trim, as in fit? Mm-hmm. Right. So somebody could say, I am strong and trim, but they lean over to pick up the grocery bag and it's an effort coming back up. So that is denying the affirmation that says, I am strong. And then that person, you know, could put some clothing on themselves and they're saying, I am trim. And they look at the mirror and the mirror is saying, but you're not trim. You know, you're a little bit in fat, you might be a little bit overweight. So it becomes harder and harder to believe those affirmations, and doesn't matter how often you repeat them. It's harder to believe them when the mirror is saying something else, right? So I'm going to tell you a story of one of my clients. She lived in a certain city in a very expensive neighborhood, which would be the equivalent of Sequoia Hills here in Knoxville. And she didn't live in a mansion, she lived in a regular house, but it was in this very expensive neighborhood. So I guess probably this house wasn't cheap, even if it wasn't a mansion, right? And I knew that she was a professional. When I walked in her house, you know, I expected something different. This was not, in my mind, this was not the home of a professional. So I had her do this exercise, and I told her, now, why don't you go outside, stay there, you know, receive some sunshine, close your eyes for a couple of minutes, and then come back inside and imagine that this is not your home, that it is somebody else's home. And when she came back in, point blank, I asked her the question, how much do you think the person who lives here makes a year? And she said, I'd say probably about $30,000 a year. And I said, well, what would give you that impression? And she said, well, the rug is kind of old. And it turns out that this woman had an amazing, luxurious rug just rolled away in her basement. So we got it out, we replaced the rugs, you know, we took out the old rug and we put the new one in. And I told her again to go outside, center herself, and come back in. And she said, well, I asked her again, how much would you say that the person in this who lives in this house makes a year? And she said, well, I'd say probably about $55,000. So I told her, well, you just gave you a $25,000 a year raise. This feedback was closer to the reality. The reality is she made close to $100,000 a year. So she was still off, you see. And so I asked her, you know, what do you think we could do in your home so that it was closer to giving you a feedback that was more in tune with reality? And she said, well, in my mind, original artwork would do it. And I asked her, do you have any original artwork? And she said, yes, it is all packed in the basement. So it's very symbolic, right? It's very symbolic about she was hiding the goodness in her life. And she was not using her own powers and the things she had to give herself a positive feedback loop. So eventually she did get the original artwork in her house, started reflecting more of what the reality of her life was. But in Feng Shui, we always want to go a little bit farther than what is. Because if you don't go farther than what is, then you just tend to get stuck in the same situation. So, how do we go a little bit beyond with establishing a positive feedback loop? And I'll give you an example of our house. I like to cook. You know, when Mark and I started dating, he signed me up for cooking lessons within a week. He said it was the best investment of his life. And, well, I love to cook because I love to eat. And so I cook a lot. And when we bought the house we live in today, I We bought this house. I bought it on the internet. Marco had moved already to Knoxville. I was still living in Iowa. So I made my decision based on the photos that the realtors had posted on the internet. And I saw that the house was hooked up for gas. And I wanted to have a gas stove because I believe that food tastes better if you cook it in a gas stove. Now, when I got there, the stove was actually an electric stove, and the piping for the gas only went as far as the water heater and the furnace, but it didn't go all the way to the kitchen. So I was stuck with an electric stove, which I didn't know it, but it was already malfunctioning. We just couldn't figure out what was going on. But one time I was making rice in a pressure cooker, and the pressure cooker exploded. And I couldn't figure out what happened because as soon as I heard that pressure cooker whistling, I had turned the heat down. And a couple of minutes after I had turned the heat down, the pressure cooker exploded. It took us a week, and you know, sometimes I'll still move something in the kitchen and we'll find a piece of rice stuck behind it. it's just no telling, you know. I can still see. Sometimes I'll find some in the ceiling that I missed. You know, we have that type of the ceiling that is not smooth. So that exploded rice really went slow with that. So it took me months. It took me about 6 to 9 months to realize what actually happened. And it's that this stove was defective. So sometimes, randomly, when it wasn't high heat and you turned it off to low heat, instead of going to low, it went to the highest. What had happened is that I had turned, you know, the heat had gone from medium high to extremely high in 2 minutes that pot exploded. And I want to put it, you know, because I'm recording the lecture, but if you want to look for me afterwards, and I'll tell you more about what happened during the explosion. And you can see my husband Marco there is laughing. Well, but this stove, you know, like, because it started, one burner was doing that, then another burner started doing that, then a third burner started doing that. So of the four burners, three were malfunctioning. And so I finally said, Marco, we have to get a new stove. And the reason I had delayed getting a new stove is that I did not want to buy an electric stove. So we finally decided, we got a contractor, and he ran the pipes from the laundry room where the water heater is. He ran the pipes through the attic, down the closet, and then to the kitchen so I could have a gas stove. And then I wrote down everything that I wanted in a stove. Well, the stove I wanted did not exist. I went to a black stove that had two ovens, five sealed burners, and that was the 30 inches width, you know, which is the standard stove. So the stove that I wanted did not exist, but it had already been designed, and it was going to be available in 2 months. They were already advertising it. So isn't that interesting? Mm-hmm. Right? So we waited the 2 months, and this stove, you know, we have a stove now. This stove is really a little bit too much for the house. You know, it's like a little bit too much stove. But in feng shui, the kitchen is directly connected to wealth. So I told Marco, you know, this is going to be an investment for our wealth. Now what happens is that I wasn't ready for so much wealth. So I end up choosing, you know, like I'm thinking, in my mind, I'm thinking that I'm making the most rational decision when buying a stove. So there was somebody locally that would sell it, but it would cost me another $400. So I bought it online from somebody who had a really good rating online. So I thought I was making a good conscious decision. Now what happened is I ordered this in Thanksgiving. And I expected to have, you know, Thanksgiving is the end of November, so I expected I would have my stove for Christmas, and we were having a family coming from Texas to spend Christmas with us. So they took a month to deliver my stove. The stove arrived on the day on New Year's Eve. Now, it's impossible to find a plumber to install a stove on New Year's Eve. I mean, not New Year's Eve. Christmas Eve. Yeah, on Christmas Eve. It's impossible to find somebody to install it on Christmas Eve. So, because our house is kind of small, we had an accessory building outside, so I told the delivery guys to put the stove in the accessory, in the porch of the accessory building. So, the people who delivered the stove, they told me, you know, this is the heaviest stove we have ever delivered. That's how much of a stove it is for our house. And it is beautiful and everything. But the thing is, you know, my old stove was already in their truck because I had paid for them to take it away. But since we couldn't find somebody to install it, they had to take it out from their truck and my old stove came back to me. So can you see how, you know, like in a certain energetic way, we were not ready to accept more wealth. So we kept wanting to let these ideas, old ideas, outdated ideas, malfunctioning ideas out the door, they kept coming back to us. So finally Monday, the plumbers arrive and only one of them comes. And I'm having a little bit of misgiving because I'm thinking the stove is really, really heavy. And they probably need two people to move. But I thought, well, this guy looks like he's pretty strong and he's had a dolly. Well, in trying to wiggle the stove on the dolly, he breaks the door of one of the ovens. So we couldn't, you know, again, our old stove was already in the truck to be hauled up. They had to get it out of the truck, put it back in our kitchen. I'm like, what's going on here? You know, there seems to be this universal resistance to us creating a positive feedback loop for wealth in our home. So then I have to order the part, right? I order the part, I leave it in the box because I don't want to run the risk of breaking it. So the plumbers come in, they open up the box, it's the wrong color. So they had to take it 2 weeks. It took us about 2 months to finally get our stove. You know, that day we actually said, you know, okay, take the door out, take the whole door out and just install our stove. So the top oven was working, but we were just using the space for the bottom oven as shelves, right? No door, and we worked like that like for a month until the right part came over and they fixed it and everything, right? So it was really interesting that 3 times that the stove had gone to the truck. And then, no, the third time, since the door was the wrong kind and it was the wrong color, they wanted to bring me back the old stove and I said, heck no, you're not doing that, you're taking that away. And you're installing the new oven even if it's without a bottom door, right? So, but the thing is, once we were able to get through all these energetic hurdles that were making things happen in such a way that we could not have our stove, that we had already paid for, but we still could not have it. You see the thing here?
Even did you realize at the time that you had mental blocks to receiving?
I was well aware because I remember thinking it had been too easy. When I had already ordered the stove and when it was supposed to be in transit, I was thinking, this is so easy. I'm going to go from this crappy little stove to an amazing, luxurious stove. And my life's going to be transformed. It's unbelievable how easy it is. I remember having that thought. And then all these things happen. But now we have our stove installed. The interesting thing is that we are both able to attract more business now that we have this wonderful stove. It really works like that. Remember I told you we were waiting for family that were visiting from Texas? Remember this Christmas, how we had snow and ice, and the roads were really dangerous, and they were driving all the way from Texas to spend Christmas with us. And the day before, the 23rd, and the day before Christmas Eve, our refrigerator died. Because I had been unhappy thinking that, okay, I have a new black dishwasher that we had replaced a few months earlier. I'm going to have an awesome, luxurious black stove, and then I'm going to have the same old refrigerator that I never have liked. So it died. It couldn't be fixed.
Where
are you calling from? Universal backing upon your desire.
It was. So Marco had to go to the store. And I had to stay home because I was cooking for our relatives that were already on the road. He got to go and get us a stove on the 24th of December. And so he sent me the pictures, you know. Good thing to have smartphones in these situations. He sent me the pictures and I chose, just like I've chosen the house, you know, through pictures. I chose the refrigerator through pictures. So now we have an awesome, beautiful kitchen with a black dishwasher, black stove, and black refrigerator, which is a lot nicer than what we had before. And definitely not as loud as the But it's been a process, and I have seen that over and over and over again, that when people decide to make positive changes to their environment, this sometimes happens, that there's this resistance to accept a better life. And I think that's really interesting, this resistance to accept a better life. So one of the things that you want to do is you want to go a little bit beyond what the reality is. So for example, this woman made close to $100,000 a year, the client that I told you about. So she should aim to make her house look like the person who lived there made $110,000 a year. Does that make sense? Now, if she aims to making her house look like she made $200,000 a year, what's going to happen? The background mind is probably not going to be in agreement with that. And that's when we see things happening like self-sabotage. So small steps, you know, and a really good book on taking small steps is called The Kaizen Way, K-A-I-Z-E-N, The Kaizen Way. It's a really good book that talks about how small steps many times work better than big changes. And in Feng Shui, we usually try to do small changes because small changes will not produce healing crisis. Sometimes, you know, this took me years to discover. Now, I used to teach classes on Feng Shui when we lived in Iowa, and one of the ladies had asked me to come and do an assessment of her home, and part of what we did is we decluttered. We moved things that had not been moved in that home in 20 years. We moved an armoire that had not been moved in that one in 15 years. The dust, you know, it was so low next to the floor that you couldn't really get a duster underneath it. The dust looked like a piece of fabric. It had compacted. You could really hold it. So she comes to the next class and she says, oh, she was so wonderful. She came to my house and we moved things around and I feel so much happier now. And I have been sick all week. She literally had been sick all week. And she's telling here everybody, I am wonderful, and therefore she has been sick all week. And so what I have discovered over the years is that the smaller the change you make, the easier it is for the person to assimilate, and then they will do other things on their own. So I will not tell a person, hey, you need to declutter your basement. I'll tell people you need to declutter the top drawer on your nightstand. Small, doable projects. Declutter means throwing away everything that you do not use, that you do not love, that is broken or plain in the trash, or things that need to be recycled, you know. You might find in the top drawer of your nightstand, you might find that invitation for that wedding 10 years ago. So there's certain things like that really don't need to be there, right? So it's important to establish reasonable goals. And it's also important to establish more than one way to measure progress. Because much of the progress happens underground for a while before it surfaces. And how are we doing on time?
Perfect.
We're okay? Okay. So, I have brought a pair of pants, but I forgot them in the car. Yes, baby.
You're 24 minutes into it.
Oh, okay. I need to learn my husband's hand signals. I think that's important for the marriage. Okay. So, for example, if somebody has a goal of losing weight, and right now they wear size 12, okay, and that person buys a mini skirt in size 4, is that a reasonable goal? What might be a reasonable goal?
Buy a size 10.
Buy a size 10. Go down a size or go down even half a size, right? That is a reasonable goal. And so I'm going to give you another example of how sometimes your space, it says something different of what you may be saying in your life. Let's talk about a couple who are both professional and they believe in equality. Not that they're the same, but that they have equal rights in the marriage and that they have equal importance in the marriage, right? So, and they say this, but when the feng shui consultant comes into the bedroom, the bed is not centered in the bedroom. The bed on one side is 10 inches away from the wall. To make room for this beautiful dresser, with a Tiffany lamp on the other side, and this awesome, beautiful rug on the floor. Would this be a bedroom that would indicate equality? It doesn't indicate quality of the person, like there's not the same room on both sides. One person has a beautiful dresser, the other person doesn't even have a nightstand. Who do you think slept on the narrow side of the bedroom?
The woman.
Actually, the husband. The woman had a beautiful dresser with a Tiffany lamp and her reading materials over there. The husband had to take his shoes off at the foot of the bed so that he could walk sideways to get to the side of the bed. So, and one way that couple can work on creating more equality is in, on moving the dresser to the other wall so they could have equal nightstands. So that will make it a lot easier for them to believe that they have a relationship in which the two sides are important. So you said I'm 24 minutes into the lecture, how long are you?
Probably 5 more minutes.
Okay. So, why do we do positive thinking? Why do we do affirmative prayer? Why do we use affirmations? The reason for that is that we are trying to transform our vibration, right? We're trying to transform our frequency. The affirmations themselves are not going to do anything. The thoughts themselves, you know, thoughts like are in the air, like Edison used to say. Thomas Edison. But the reason that we engage in positive thinking, the reason that we use affirmative prayer, scientific prayer, is because we want to transform ourselves. And it is ultimately our frequency that determines what we attract into our lives. So the point of affirmations and positive thinking is to transform our frequency. So remember I told you we were waiting for family that were visiting from Texas? Remember this Christmas, how we had snow and ice, and the roads were really dangerous, and they were driving all the way from Texas to spend Christmas with us. And the day before, the 23rd, and the day before Christmas Eve, our refrigerator died. Because I had been unhappy thinking that, okay, I have a new black dishwasher that we had replaced a few months earlier. I'm going to have an awesome luxurious black stove, and then I'm going to have the same old refrigerator that I never have liked. So it died. It couldn't be fixed.
So
Universal acting upon your desire.
It was. So Marco had to go to the store. And I had to stay home because I was cooking for our relatives that were already on the road. He got to go and get us a stove on the 24th of December. And so he sent me the pictures, you know. Good thing to have smartphones in these situations. He sent me the pictures, and I chose, just like I've chosen the house, through pictures. I chose the refrigerator through pictures. So now we have an awesome, beautiful kitchen with a black dishwasher, black stove, and black refrigerator, which is a lot nicer than what we had before. And definitely not as loud as before. But it's been a process, and I have seen that over and over and over again. So when people decide to make positive changes to their environment, this sometimes happens, that there's this resistance to accept a better life. And I think that's really interesting, this resistance to accept a better life. So one of the things that you want to do is you want to go a little bit beyond what the reality is. So for example, this woman made close to $100,000 a year, the client that I told you about. So she should aim to make her house look like the person who lived there made $110,000 a year. Does that make sense? Now, if she aims to making her house look like she made $200,000 a year, what's going to happen? The background mind is probably not going to be in agreement with that. And that's when we see things happening like self-sabotage. So small steps, you know, and a really good book on taking small steps is called The Kaizen Way. K-A-I-Z-E-N, The Kaizen Way. It's a really good book that talks about how small steps many times work better than big changes. And in feng shui, we usually try to do small changes because small changes will not produce healing crisis. Sometimes, you know, this took me years to discover. Now, I used to teach classes on feng shui in, when we lived in Iowa, and one of the ladies had asked me to come and do an assessment of her home, and part of what we did is we decluttered. We moved things that had not been moved in that home in 20 years. We moved an armoire that had not been moved in 15 years. the dust, you know, it was so low next to the floor that you couldn't really get a duster underneath it. The dust looked like a piece of fabric. It had compacted. You could really hold it. So she comes to the next class and she says, oh, she was so wonderful. She came to my house and we moved things around and I feel so much happier now. And I have been sick all week. She literally had been sick all week. And she's telling here everybody, I am wonderful, and therefore she has been sick all week. And so what I have discovered over the years is that the smaller the change you make, the easier it is for the person to assimilate, and then they will do other things on their own. So I will not tell a person, hey, you need to declutter your basement. I'll tell people you need to declutter the top drawer on your nightstand. Small, doable projects. Declutter means throwing away everything that you do not use, that you do not love, that is broken or plainly trash, or things that need to be recycled, you know. You might find in the top drawer of your nightstand, you might find that invitation for that wedding 10 years ago. So there's certain things like that that really don't need to be there, right? So it's important to establish reasonable goals. And it's also important to establish more than one way to measure progress. Because much of the progress happens underground for a while before it surfaces. And how are we doing on time?
We're okay.
Okay. So, I have brought a pair of pants, but I forgot them in the car. Yes, baby.
You're 24 minutes into it.
Oh, okay. I need to learn my husband's hand signals. I think that's important for the marriage. Okay. For example, if somebody has a goal of losing weight, and right now they wear size 12, okay, and that person buys a pair of a mini skirt in size 4, is that a reasonable goal? What might be a reasonable goal?
Buy a size 10.
Buy a size 10. Go down a size or go down even half a size, right? That is a reasonable goal. And so I'm going to give you another example of how sometimes your space, it says something different to what you may be saying in your life. Let's talk about a couple who are both professional and they believe in equality. Not that they're the same, but that they have equal rights in the marriage and that they have equal importance in the marriage, right? So, and they say this, but when the feng shui consultant comes into the bedroom, the bed is not centered in the bedroom. The bed on one side is 10 inches away from the wall. To make room for this beautiful dresser with a Tiffany lamp on the other side and this awesome, beautiful rug on the floor. Would this be a bedroom that would indicate equality? It doesn't indicate equality. First enough, there's not the same room on both sides. One person has a beautiful dresser, the other person doesn't even have a nightstand. Who do you think slept on the narrow side of the bedroom?
The woman.
Actually, the husband. The woman had a beautiful dresser with a Tiffany lamp in her reading materials over there. The husband had to take his shoes off at the foot of the bed so that he could walk sideways to get to the side of the bed. So, and one way that couple can work on creating more equality is in on moving the dresser to the other wall so they could have equal nightstands. So that will make it a lot easier for them to believe that they have a relationship in which the two sides are important. So you said I'm 24 minutes into the lecture. How long are you?
Probably 5 more minutes.
Okay. So, why do we do positive thinking? Why do we do affirmative prayer? Why do we use affirmations? The reason for that is that we are trying to transform our vibration, right? We're trying to transform our frequency. The affirmations themselves are not going to do anything. The thoughts themselves, you know, thoughts like are in the air, like Elisa used to say. Thomas Edison. But the reason that we engage in positive thinking, the reason that we use affirmative prayer, scientific prayer, is because we want to transform ourselves. And it is ultimately our frequency that determines what we attract into our lives. So the point of affirmations and positive thinking is to transform our frequency.